Hi, we're the Pfister family. Welcome to service at First Church Belmont. Please join us in saying,
Life is a gift for which we are grateful. We gather in community to celebrate the glories and the mysteries of this great gift.
Hi. My name is Chris Holton-Jabonski, and it is my great joy and my deep honor to serve you all as your minister and to welcome you to another wonderful worship service. I'm so glad that you're here, so glad for the precious gift of this time and for all that's about to happen. Want to lift up a couple things before we get going. The first is that later today, we have the next installment of First Church Cooks. It's a wonderful new class in which you get to zoom into each other's kitchens and cook together, hear wonderful things. There should be information about it in this email that probably brought you this service or in the Unitarian, lots of ways in. And even if you can only sign up for next month, it's a really great thing that's happening. So do be sure to check that out. And coming a little bit later this week, we have this year's Moth Story Time, where lots of different people from the church share stories. Should be really great. That's on the 26th. So you can, in the same emails in the Unitarian, you can find the link for that. But that's always been a really great evening. So do please check that out. And then lastly, as you probably know by now, we're in the midst of our stewardship time, which has been wonderful. Our hardworking stewardship team, they deserve so much thanks. This is a difficult job any year, and this year it's especially difficult. And so we're so grateful for our hardworking stewardship team. And so please help them out in this precious, very important work that they're doing, and make your pledge. You can pledge online. You can pledge through the website, lots of different ways in, but it's a huge support for them and all of their hard work and for, you know, me and all the rest of the staff. Everybody is working so hard, and it makes so much possible both for this year and next year and the future. So do please pledge. But for now, for this time stretched out before us, come, let us worship together.
Hello, dear First Church friends. I'm Monty Allen. I've been thinking about our sanctuary, where we gather to share our celebrations and our concerns, where couples get married, where we mourn our losses and console each other, where we draw strength from our personal connections with each other, and where we get to sing right out loud. The deprivation we're experiencing now more than ever reminds us how much we value being able to get together in person and how eager we are to regain all that our sanctuary has to offer to us. And I've been thinking also about the notion of sanctuary, refuge, protection, safety, a retreat that offers us peace and calmness and quiet. It's all good, but it's all about us. It's all inward facing, and we're not all there is. You and I are links in the long and precious chain that connects the past to the future, with previous generations handing things off to us with the admonition, don't screw things up. And subsequent generations sitting in judgment on whether or not and to what extent we did screw things up. Each generation has faced challenges, and at the time, each of those challenges, I'm sure, felt really important, but none are as profoundly consequential as the challenges we face. Global warming has the potential to break down human civilization, and ultimately to make our planet uninhabitable. So now more than ever, the future for human life, and for other forms of life as well, depends on us. The deadlines are unforgiving. The clock is ticking. And I'm reminded of a line from a Jimi Hendrix song, All Along the Watchtower. Let us not talk falsely now. The hour is getting late. Each of us will need to make some changes in the way that we live. But really, there's only so much that we can do individually. And considering the scale of the corrective action that needs to be taken, the real agency lies in our institutions. Every institution. The UN, governments at all levels, businesses, educational institutions, nonprofit organizations, every institution, including the First Church in Belmont, Unitarian Universalist, has to be part of the solution. We have to. In fact, communities of faith, as reservoirs of values, and as the conscience of our society, has a particularly important role to play. And with respect for the interdependent web of all existence of which we're a part, is one of our core values. UU congregations need to be in the vanguard of this collective effort. Now more than ever, we have a huge outward-facing responsibility. And we're to be held globally and historically accountable. If we're to meet that responsibility, we're going to have to keep our church and our congregation strong and united. So let our sanctuary be of importance, not just to us. Let our sanctuary also be a source of energy, of shared commitment and determination, of mutual encouragement. Let our sanctuary be a source of rejuvenation, resilience, and reassurance as we take up what humanity and history rightly expect from us.
Peace and freedom is our cry. Peace and freedom. cry. Without these, this world would die. Peace and freedom is our cry.
So a few days had passed in Good Spring Woods when our creature friends heard from a friendly mole named Miley McIrv that the bear had come to a community nearby where the creatures weren't ready and were scared and surprised. The bear was said to have ate their berries and fish and chased after them like they were his next dish. And although all of them survived, it was surely a rough time to be alive. Their homes were ruined, destroyed, and left a mess, so Stu started to think of those creatures who had less. "We should go and see if they need help," said Stu, our squirrel friend who often knew what to do. "What?" cried some of the creatures. "We need to be smart, not silly or daring or brave at heart. We have to protect our homes in these woods and ignore the we oughtas, we kens, and we shoulds. And who knows, the bear could still be there. Yes, the bear could still be there." But after a long pause and a telling stare that said, "Come on, guys, forget the bear," they decided it was time to hit the road and to see if the other creatures were fine. And as a team, they came together and widened the circle that be, helping and including others, reaching out and building community.
The time in our service where we invite forward an offering to help support the good work of the church both within and beyond our walls and to help support the good work of our partners in the wider world. For the month of February, we're sharing our offering with UU Mass Action, an incredible organization that helps Unitarian Universalist communities serve and support grassroots organizing efforts all across the area. So do please give generously. You can go to uubelmont.org/giving. And as you've been hearing about, it's also the beginning of our stewardship process. So do please pledge. Keep your eyes open for your pledge information coming in the mail. You can also pledge online, all sorts of ways in. And all of your generosity is deeply appreciated, both for the church and for our partners in the wider world. So thank you so much.
There was a time our happiness seemed never ending. I was so sure that where we were heading was right. Life was a road so certain and straight and unbending. Our little road with never a crossroad in sight. Back in the days when we spoke in civilized voices, women in white and sturdy young men at the oar. Back in the days when I let you make all my choices. We can never go back to before. Time my feet were so solidly planted, you'd sail away while I turned my back to the sea. I was content, a princess asleep and enchanted. If I had dreams, then I let you dream them for me. Back in the days when everything seemed so much clearer, women in white who knew what their lives had in store. Where are they now, those women who stared from the mirror? We can never go back to before. There are people out there unafraid of that they might have a feeling, or they might have been wrong. There are people out there unafraid to feel sorrow, unafraid of tomorrow, unafraid to be weak, unafraid to be
This is To Keep Moving Forward by Reverend Gretchen Haley. And it begins with the words of Octavia Butler, who writes, "All you touch, you change. And all that you change, changes you. The only lasting truth is change." And then Gretchen Haley writes, "Will you pray with me now? We need a prayer for all the stuck places in our bodies and our hearts and our minds. We need a prayer for the stuck places in our families and in our world, for all those days when it feels like everything is caught in an endless loop of same and status quo and sterility. What has been will be, and what has been done will be done." These are words from thousands of years ago, the book of Ecclesiastes, but still they ring true. So this is our prayer. Help us to get over ourselves. Help us to release ourselves from the restrictions that fear and grief and white supremacy have kept on our imaginations, open us to holy possibilities that are available in this moment and every moment. Connect us to the change that is in everywhere, the change that is in the dirt, the change in the trees, in the rocks, in the river, in the yellow squash flower, and the once in 6,000 years appearance of flying stars. Connect us to our own power, the shifting plates of our hearts, and tend still to the grief of all that has been lost. Tend to the grief of all we keep losing, the unfair choices and the no good options we find ourselves with. Give us the courage to wail in anger so that we may make space in our lungs for a new song, a lullaby for all that is being born in this great and living darkness. Now, more than ever, it matters that we remember this connection, that we remember this change holding us always, that we are held in wider and wider circles of accountability and concern. Now, more than ever, it matters that we are living and making our way, mindful of more than ourselves, mindful of the relationships of the beautiful web of concern that hold us in memory and hope. As many of you know, we recently had a series of listening circles, which were fascinating and fantastic. I'm so grateful for everyone who participated. So many of you shared wonderful ideas. The report is coming. Stay tuned. One moment among so many that really stuck out with me, I want to share with you today. I'm always aware of our youngest baby in the congregation and our eldest elder, and everyone else sprinkled in the great in between, but there is always a youngest baby and there is always an eldest elder. And in this one meeting, we met little Felix, then just 4 weeks old. Felix is the brand new baby of Katie and Fedya Lubungo. And mom and he were in that precious little Zoom box on the screen, his little impossibly small self just curled up in his mom in that perfect little baby perch that's one of my favorite things that exists in this world. Angelic and then fussy, just right. And James Henke was there as well. And so we were talking about his beloved, Rebecca, who died at the beginning of this all, almost 1 year ago. She was the last person I was allowed to go visit in the hospital, the last person I was allowed to bring holy water and a blossom and bless her as she prepared to die, to hold the family as they all prepared for her to die. And there was little baby Felix, all beginning and potential, and mom, Katie, perfectly exhausted. They also have a 2-year-old, so a 2-year-old, a 4-week-old, and both parents working. And James, now 1 year into this new living, after a lifetime with his beloved, making his new way. And this is part of the gift of this widening circle, that we know and are known, that we hold one another and are held. And as Monty reminds us today and so often, we are held in even wider circles. We know that we exist for our wider community, for our nation, for our planet. We exist in this moment, mindful of and accountable to Felix and all of the generations which will come after. Standing on the shoulders of our elders, of Bob Eisendrath, age 93, of Ilse Kaprelian, age 90, and our eldest elder, Trudy Edges, age 100, and our recently died Laura Miller. We are woven across the generations, all united in common purpose and mission, and this is a beautiful thing. and it matters now more than ever. This is what we commit ourselves to, both with this stewardship process, but also in all of our volunteering, in our committees and our programs. We commit ourselves over and over to this world we are seeking to build. This world with more love and more justice. This world with more beauty and more good. This world in which we are held and holding, loving and loved. I am so grateful for waking up to this world, waking up to this moment, waking up to this web of love, holding Felix and Trudy and all of us in between. This circle of accountability stretching out so wide and so vast. I am grateful for this good beginning and for all that comes next. So much love to you all. Amen. Blessed Are We, by Andrea Hawkins Camper. Blessed are we who gather with open hearts together today. Blessed are we, the chalice lighters of resistance, justice, love, and faith. Blessed are we, the heretics, the outcasts, the walkers of our own way. Blessed are we, the border crossers, the refugees, the immigrants, the poor, the wanderers who are not lost. Blessed are we, the transgressors, the trespassers, the passers-by, the cause takers, the defiant, the compliant. Blessed are we, the hand extenders, the sign makers, the protesters, the protectors. Blessed are we, the trans women, trans men, the non-binary, the cisgender, the multigender, the no gender. Blessed are we, the friend, the stranger, the lonely, the hidden, the visible, the authentic. Blessed are we who rise in solidarity. Blessed are we who cannot. Blessed are we who do not. Blessed are we, for this is our beloved community. And this is who we are. Amen.